Good morning, everybody, and welcome to day three of the Cascadia Poetry Festival. Day three because we did officially start on Thursday afternoon. My name is Kim Goldberg. I will be hosting this first panel. This morning, our topic is Where Geography, Culture, and Language Intersect. Our three panelists, whom I will be introducing in a moment, are David McCloskey, Robert Bringhurst, and Harold Rehnisch. First, we have some thank yous, acknowledgments, opening remarks to make. The whole festival would very much like to thank the Nanaimo First Nation, on whose traditional territory we are gathered this weekend for this festival. We would also like to thank Vancouver Island University, where we are right now, for providing space and support, and the VIU Faculty of Arts and Humanities for their financial assistance that has made part of this festival possible. We thank the Nanaimo Tourism Development Fund, the Canada Council for the Arts, the League of Canadian Poets, the Writers Union of Canada, and Cascadia Now for their funding as well. We've had many business sponsors for this event. Their logos are all in our program, and we would ask you to support our business sponsors in the way they've supported us to make this possible. So, the title of this panel this morning is Geography, Culture, and Language, Where They Intersect. Now, one of the things that becomes very clear to anybody who heard David McCloskey's lecture yesterday morning on Cascadia geography and mapping this bioregion is that map making entails much more than drawing a boundary in two-dimensional space. It involves looking backward through time and history, as well as looking vertically up to the winds above and down to the tectonic plates and magma below. For these features and more, all have their influence in shaping and creating the landscape that is being defined by a map. They are, in fact, a part of the landscape, so they must be represented in some way, even if just indirectly, in any mapping of that landscape. There are also all of the different cultural presences, both current and historic, that are occupying a landscape. Depending on which language we are speaking or are fluent in, we may see and define and interpret this landscape very differently. And I don't just mean human language. There is the language of tidal action, scrubbing the foreshore, the poetry of the changing seasons, the alarm call of a beaver's tail slapping the surface of a pond before diving deep. All of these things, at least in my mind, are part of the laminar, multi-layered quality of Cascadia that David was describing yesterday morning when he unveiled the beautiful new edition of the Cascadia map. And so we wanted to see what would happen, what further revelations and synthesis of ideas might arise if we combined these three resource people on a panel to discuss the intersections between geography, culture, and language. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about each of the three panelists you'll be hearing, and then turn it over to them. And we will, at the end, have an opportunity for discussion, questions, and it should be very interesting. Our first speaker today will be David McCloskey. He's an emeritus professor of Seattle University. For more than three decades, David taught in the sociology, anthropology department, as well as in the ecological studies program, which he co-founded. He created and taught more than 100 different courses in 10 different departments or programs throughout his tenure there. David is a longtime bioregionalist who's spoken and written widely on bioregionalism in general and on Cascadia, our bioregion specifically. He's also the founder and director of the Cascadia Institute. He created the first maps of the Ish River country, which he showed us yesterday in his talk. That's now officially known as the Salish Sea. And he created the first maps of Cascadia itself. His latest edition of the map was unveiled here at the festival yesterday morning during David's lecture on Cascadia geography. Our second panelist, who is actually seated on the far end, will be Harold Rehnisch, Over the last three decades, Harold has published 27 books of poetry, environmental writing, social criticism, memoir, and stories. He's won numerous writing awards, including the George Riga Prize for Social Responsibility, the Malahat Review Long Poem Prize, and CBC Literary Prize. For the last 3 years, he has been writing the cross-border environmental blog OkanaganOkanagan.com. Okanagan spelled both ways, the Canadian way and the American way. The blog merges science, photography, and poetry into a vision for sustainable environmental technology. Harold's blog has been a springboard for two new projects, book projects of his, a collection of Cascadia poems, and a bioregional book about the history and culture of the Columbia Plateau and salmon. Harold has been a writer in residence in Iceland and more locally at Okanagan Regional Library. He lives on the edge of the grasslands above Okanagan Landing. And our final panelist on this topic will be Robert Bringhurst, who's seated in the middle. Robert was born in California, raised in the Rocky Mountains and the Great Basin, and has lived for the last 40 years on the British Columbia coast. He was trained as a linguist and has translated extensively from classical Haida, classical Arabic, and classical Greek. He is the author of more than 30 books, more than half of which are poetry. His selected poems are published by Jonathan Cape in London and by Gaspereau Press in Canada. Two of his best-known books are A Story as Sharp as a Knife, The Classical Haida Myth Tellers and Their World, and also The Elements of Typographic Style, which has been translated into 10 languages. He lives on Quadra Island off the British Columbia coast. Our first speaker today will be David McCloskey.
Good day. It's an honor to be here with this distinguished panel. Since I'm not a morning person, I'm going to ask for some help. I saw myself a ring of bone in the clear stream of all of it. I saw myself a ring of bone in the clear stream of all of it, and vowed always to remain open to it, that it all might flow through. Then I heard, ring of bone, where ringing is what a bell does. Can I use 1 more minute to go all the way around? I saw myself a ring of bone.
I saw myself a ring of bone
in the clear stream of all of it, and vowed always to remain open to it, that it all might flow through. I learned the song. It didn't have a song to it. It was Lou Welch's great, great poem, and. Couldn't get it in the city. Finally in the Oregon coast, just walking the waves, walking the waves. Finally the song came through. Then I heard, ring of bone, where ring is what a bell does. A quintessential Cascadian poem, because it placed, it's immersion, not projection. And it places us in the very heart of the flow. And says, be there. So the question of what is Cascadian poetry arises right away. Is it being in the territory? So everybody who is in the jurisdictions is a Cascadian poet. To me that sounds like in a box, a container. So maybe it's speaking about the place. And so many wonderful, wonderful poets and poems do that. The words that came up out of the ground as the loon learns his song from the lake. I want to learn to stand still, make roots from words, take in the language of the place I've made my home. There's one more step there, and that's when it inhabits you. So there is a tendency to go with icons and simply large the poem up with geographic references, with mountains and rivers and names and birds and trees. And that's okay, it starts the grounding process. But the problem is with both of those being in or about, they stay on the surface of things. Remember yesterday I was talking about kind of that horizontal plane? We could talk about Cascadian poetry as a certain stance, a technique, a form. And there's something clearly to be said about that, but I'm going to leave that debate to you folks. Except say that there are many different voices singing in many different ways, from many different places, on many different planes. I could see Cascadian love songs. I'd like to see Cascadian work songs. Maybe someone up here could get Tom Wayman or Kate, Braid? Kate?
Yeah.
Braid? Yeah. In the end, though, and that's largely where we've been, especially in the self. In the end, I suggest, as grounding as they may be for the first attempt, they're all going to dead end. That whole stance, that whole vein is going to dead end. We're talking about reflection. We're talking about giving a framework here. The reason is it stays not only on the same surface, but it stays within the same framework. And the given framework are a whole set of categories we've inherited that we need now to unlearn. Well, how do we begin again? Okay, I ask the question, when in the poem and in the world, who is speaking to whom? So if it's this poet speaking to the self, if it's this reverie, this self-referential reverie, as it were, then this poet is speaking, the artist, whomever, is speaking to himself, about himself, from inside himself, then why should anybody else care? Then you have no audience. So I'd say, hey, let's start from not just the surface of things, but let's try to go into the depth, and I suggest that we have one access, like yesterday, by deep diving into that field. But I want to turn that field from geography now to phenomenology and to poetics. So why don't we begin with that great line, the whole world speaks. Stafford, not the whole world speaks. Okay, so let's begin with vocare, with speaking and listening, with calling, vocation and evocation. And I have the feeling, especially when I used to get to go out and hike, that the whole forest was watching. And it took me the longest time to shut the hell up and stop running that little closed loop of all my tribulations in the city and let it go. It takes like 3 days before you leave the city, before you can really start to become present. So that means then hearing or listening, getting those voices through. So there's this. Finally, let's just say, after 3 days, a deep auscultation, a listening in depth becomes possible. And I think that listening initiates the first stage of poesis here. And that's becoming present to the presence. And I want to suggest that field in depth yesterday, think about that as a field of presence. And the question then is becoming present to that presencing. And I think you all know what that feeling is, and that's where poetry begins. And once those voices come through to you, and those sounds that call, there's a calming inside, because that poetry itself is ultimately a lonely, lost vocation. It doesn't lead out of itself. So, if you get in that certain mode, you're in the woods or in the shore, the sound of the calling comes through as a gift. And so I think we begin in the potlatch sphere with the three rules of moral ecology, right? It's all a gift, and the gift has a life of its own. Two, the gift must move, and three, you give as you are given. So that's where I say Cascadian poiesis begins, in the potlatch, which is the double giveaway. You all know the potlatch? You know why it's a double giveaway? Have you heard that before?
No.
Double giveaway. So, okay, you know the potlatch, I'll just cut to the chase. In the potlatch, you summon all the family and friends and the neighboring tribes, the neighbors, the near fellow dwellers, and you give away, as the gift of the song was given to you, you give that spirit power away in turn. And that's what they're there for, all the assembled guests that you give the gifts to. Not to, they got it wrong with the Kwakiutl and the potlatch and so on. It wasn't the big man proud status games alone at all, really. It was about witnessing the power of the spirit world, which gave you your gift, your name, your power. That's how you made a living. That's how you made your way in the world. You had a tutelary spirit, a guiding spirit. But that means that then you begin with that spirit world. So the surface that we inhabit, the thin skin with spirit on either side, right? That's the sense you finally get. So in the gift of the world, in the gift the world speaks. We attune and learn to listen. So if you would speak, we must first learn to listen. So two kind of stages there, the world speaking to you, rather than you speaking, how the river made me feel today, to the world speaking, the spirit, the song of the world speaking through you. But you have to be invited to that. So the poet is this slender, resonant reed, a reed as in an instrument that the breath flows through.
You've got 5 minutes left.
So okay, I'm done.
Sorry.
Okay, then I'll have to act it out. So here's the gift. I'm supposed to be by that. So the gift is given, you learn to attune and learn to listen to it. It takes it in, and all the skill and the gifts of the poet transforms it, transmutes it, and gives it in turn. So I'm interested in this whole cycle of poesis, not the poem alone. Too small, thin, pellicle, too small. So we recover the larger world and said, who do you want? You're speaking to another. She's speaking to you. And they are then witnessing the power of that gift, the gift of the song, that you now have added a new gift to. And so then that person, the resonance that started the gift itself, resonates again in a new way in the because the reader, the listener is part of your process, right? I mean, they're part of the co-creators of the meaning. So the witness, the listener, witnesses to the gift of the song that was given and is given in a new way, hands it on. So an essential part of Cascadia poesis is the witnessing. It's not just the writer, it's the witnessing. Because then the witness, the receiver, takes the song and sings it and says, you should have heard those people yesterday. Wow, they were really hot. The place was jamming. Let me sing you the song. You can't help it, right? It overflows. The gift must move. It always overflows any container that you have. So the gift is, the song is told and retold, and in that telling and retelling, culture begins to emerge, a shared evocation begins to emerge. I got 2 minutes left?
Yes.
I'll cut to the chase. Okay, so then the whole cycle begins from the gift given to you, the slender, resonant reed, who then sings it again and hands it on, and then those people re-sing it, retell it. But that's not the where it ends. So I'll end where it ends. The question is, can you sing the song back well enough so that the world hears. Because the world is watching. It is listening. And what does it want to know? It wants to know if you're any fun. Can you throw a good celebration? And do you want it to give? And if you then are worthy, if we, our culture, are worthy to become part of that great good gift, then Cascadian poesis, what we might call that, whole process of giving and receiving and witnessing and giving in turn in a whole new way, then you have a chance for a new culture.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. That was David McCloskey. Our next speaker is Harold Rehnisch, and because Harold is showing slides, we are going to take seats in the audience so we can watch the slides.
Sounds fair. Thank you, everyone, for coming so early in the morning to celebrate with us. Much appreciated. Nice to see you all. Here's someone you've been looking at for a while. I call this Swimming Towards the Bone. We are on the Hanford Reach. This buck has just crossed the Columbia River, and he's about to climb onto the shore and walk towards the plutonium reactors that created the plutonium for the Trinity test, the Nagasaki bomb, and 65% of the Cold War arsenal. There he goes. A story of compromise and renewal in the heart of Cascadia. If you've never taken the jet boat tour up the Hanford Reach, it's the only wild stretch of the Columbia in the United States, and it's worth every minute. So let's, I'm hoping that in this few minutes that we have to talk here, that I can bring you to help celebrate with me the idea that my country, the dry grasslands on the other side of the mountains and the rainforest on this side of the mountains are the same place. So we'll see if we can get there. Okay. In my country, the old growth forests are 3 feet high. And although they are made out of grass, it is a more productive, more abundant, and more diverse landscape than the old growth cedar forests of the coast. Amazing. But it is true. More species diversity, more endangered species, on it goes. It just doesn't look like it when you're not familiar with what is actually going on. A few years back, I was working as editor on the photographic book Spirit in the Grass about the caribou Chilcotin grasslands, the last surviving pristine bunch grass on the planet, virtually unchanged in 4,000 years, maintained for that time by human care. And I was sitting there and I said to Ordell Steen, the ecologist who had devoted his life to trying to understand these grasslands, I said, what do I need to know? And he said, you will understand the grass when you understand that trees are weeds. A reverse of the normal West Coast way of thinking. Just a little further introduction to my country, the Okanagan Valley is cut in two by a border, and this has isolated the two halves of the valley. 400,000 people live on the Canadian side of the border, 50,000 live on the American side of the border. And the funny thing is, on the northern side of the border, in the town of Asuyas, there are Spanish houses, there are wineries everywhere you look, there is a beach culture, it is summer, hot, party time, this is the desert, it's blazingly hot, thousands of people come, it's beautiful. You go 5 feet onto the American side, south, where it is hotter, okay? And you're in a cold northern shrub steppe where no one goes except for a few deer hunters and some steelhead fishermen. That's it. There is no tourist industry except for a few longtime Okanagan, Canadian Okanagan residents fleeing to Conconally Lake in the summer to get rid of the Canadian tourists on Okanagan Lake. It's weird, okay? I have a friend in Seattle. Many of you are from Seattle, okay? He's a poet. We won't say his name. He's from North Carolina. He's lived in Seattle for 35 years. And he will not cross the mountains to go east to eastern Washington. No matter how much I've begged, no matter the tantalizing tours I've set up, he will not come. And I finally got him to tell me the reason he will not come. I'm not making fun of him. He is deadly serious, and he has historical grounds for saying this. But across the mountains is the Confederacy, and he is not going to go among those people because for him, the Civil War has not ended and it is being fought in Washington today. Dead serious. If I have myself crossed the pass between Cedro Woolley and Winthrop, and as I've crossed the pass in an election year, there aren't many election years, as I've crossed the pass, I was greeted by a big billboard, right, that said, do not let Seattle steal another election from us. Vote Republican. So Jim is maybe onto something. Say, there, I told you his name. You're going to look him up. So let's take a look at, a little story about myself. I traveled 6 years ago, up my river, the Columbia. I'm from British Columbia, but the Columbia, not the Fraser, is my river. And I said, I want to travel my river from the sea to the mountains like a salmon. And I did, and it was the most glorious thing I have ever done. And 6 days later, I arrived at the border crossing at Robson outside of Trail at 9:30 at night. And the border guard, a nice man from Quebec, from the country of Canada, he didn't want to let me cross the border because I had started in Vancouver, I lived in Campbell River, and I was, you know, hundreds of miles to the east crossing again. He thought I was running drugs. He was not going to let me cross the border. We had to negotiate for 50 minutes. I said, but I was born on this river. I'm a poet. I'm writing a book about the salmon and the river I love. I tried 3 times to explain that. I finally gave up. And we finally negotiated. But I was really upset that a man from a foreign country, Canada, had come to my country, the Columbia, and was denying me crossing into the next stage of my river. That was annoying, you know? So maybe I'm a little like my friend Jim. So take a look at this picture of Hanford here. In the back, you can see that there's a sandbar here that's largely covered with grass. You don't want to let the level of the Columbia rise too high because then it's going to drain more radioactive groundwater out of the Hanford site. So you've got to control that very carefully, but you've got to raise it for the salmon to spawn, and then you've got to lower it again. Okay. The silt bluffs in the back, those are the, there's about 20 miles of silt bluffs there, okay, white bluffs, and that is the fine wind-drifted loess that settled on the southern wall of the continental glaciers in the last ice age, all moved around by catastrophic post-glacial floods that carved eastern Washington. That's what you're looking at. So let's move on. Maybe. Isn't that great? Such a functional.
Just hit the arrow button on your computer.
Pardon me?
Can you just hit the arrow button on your computer?
I'm going to have to, but we're going to have to. Okay, so I call my homeland the basalt sea. And this is the native fishery at Incomeet, 2.5 miles of the river and the largest surviving sockeye run of traditionally 25,000 fish, now over 100,000, on a river that once supported 30 million fish.
So, my neighborhood.
Here we are. The map is turned on its side because that fit on my computer, but also it's a globe. It's spherical. Doesn't matter, does it?
So,
this line, very roughly, that's the Nootka Fault, goes right through the southern point of Quadra Island and continues on almost to the Rockies. And that is where an ancient seafloor plate called the Farallon Plate has broken in two and is creating most of what we see on the surface. There it is,
cutting across Quadra Island,
moving a cart
in that direction.
And if you notice to the left, there's a chunk of the plate that is very slowly circling counterclockwise. It has been doing that. It has been stuck there for about 130 million years. It's not moving. No one knows why. And in the Columbia, the general drift to the south is in the opposite direction. Interesting pattern.
Wow.
This is a picture of the glaciers. Notice the glaciers. The high point of the glaciers, the continental divide, followed the Nootka Fault. The highest point of the glaciers. The blue line is more or less the southern limit in Washington. The yellow line is where they moved the continental divide by shifting gravel, 1,000 kilometers to the north. Notice also on the Nootka Fault, we have subglacial volcanoes. They look like this.
And much else.
After the glaciers melted, the fjord-like valleys and rifts of the interior scarred by glaciers filled up with water, making massive inland seas.
Including the biggest one was in Missoula, and it's off the edge.
Here's one, Okanagan Lake, the remnants of one, just outside my house. Some kid lit a fire, and we had a nice burn that year. There is a new theory that to get enough water to create the massive floods in Washington, all the water could not have come from Montana and Idaho. There had to be another source. So currently there's explorations looking towards British Columbia and the theory that perhaps the trigger that set all these events off at once was the explosion of the subglacial volcanoes in the Clearwater volcanic complex. One of the things that happened, just out of interest for BC coastal people, is that the Fraser River, which was a river draining into the Beaufort Sea, reversed its course and cut down through the Fraser Canyon in half a day and has flowed south ever since.
Do you know that? Is that true?
Yes. Three minutes left? Okay. And here we are in the subglacial flood core at Dry Falls. And what I'm going to do is just show you how human settlement has followed this volcanic track through the grass. So in British Columbia, we have a chain of shield volcanoes in the West Chilcotin, shield volcanoes being very low volcanoes like the Hawaiian Islands coming from the Earth's mantle over a stationary plume. And they are the Rainbow, Itcha, Ilgachus, and Nazco volcanoes. The Nazco is considered to be the most likely volcano to erupt in Canada. Here we are hiking in the ruins of the Rainbow volcano. Here is a look at the Rainbow volcano. That's a glacial valley that's cut through the middle of it. Notice the peak on the right. It's called Anaheim Peak. That's what a stream bed on Anaheim Peak looks like. That's obsidian.
6,000 years ago, this peak was the center of trade in the Northwest. That obsidian was traded as far south as San Diego and into the Great Plains, creating the obsidian trail. You can see it going down the Fraser, cutting across, going down the Okanagan all the way to Celilo, where it was distributed from there. Picked up ochre and flint in the Tulamine. Picked up Ulican grease down in Bellicula. Picked up salmon at Celilo, and the trading went on. Notice that in 1858, when there was a gold rush in British Columbia, the route to the gold rush came two ways. We're quite familiar with the story of the miners coming to Victoria and going up the Fraser River through Fort Langley and up to Yale and thereabouts, which is the yellow line at the bottom. That was about 30,000 men. 10,000 men came in the out of the interior, and they came up from the Dalles on the Columbia, and they followed the old obsidian trail. That trail is still there. Most of the settlements in the grasslands are still lying on that ancient trail. But one of the consequences is we now have two stories. We have a settlement story on the coast with a different experience and a different history than the settlement in the interior. And the purple there is the Hanford and the dams on the Columbia. So we're presented with lots of opportunities for discussions to cross this line. We didn't get to the story of the mountains. Do I have like 1 minute left?
Sure, 1 minute.
1 minute. The thing that unites these two ecosystems and these two histories is the mountains, the coastal volcanoes which thrust up into the sky, and they create, through pressure effects, the rainforest on one side, and through negative pressure effects, the grasslands to the other side. The challenge that I see we have culturally is to understand that to treat water on the eastern side of the mountains as if it was water on the western sides leads to drought, poverty, loss of environmental sustainability, and loss of the ability of the land to support us and our children. Not through anybody's bad intent, but just because everything about water on the other side is its mirror. When we feel cold and wet on the coast, that is an effect of the water and the air pressure in the atmosphere. That is the shadow of the mountain. We are feeling the mountain. When we are on the other side in the grass and we're feeling hot and dry, it is also the shadow of the mountain. And the rivers move the cold glacial water through this system and keep it operating. Anything else? You can ask questions. Good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carol. Our final speaker on the panel is Robert Bringhurst. And after Robert speaks, we will all reassemble up here. They will talk to each other a bit, and then we'll open it up for your questions and comments.
Can we look at your butt instead of that?
Pardon me?
Can we look at your butt instead of that?
He's better than that, isn't he?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you get talking and I'll get him.
It's a treat it is to be in such fine company. These guys, you folks, thank you very much.
I'm sorry.
I hope most of you heard David's wonderful lecture yesterday morning. It was a fabulous presentation. But he said one thing that truly shocked me. He said his map was finished. Maps are never finished. Maps are never finished. There are always layers you can add and other layers you can pull out so that you can see what you've added or see what was there in the first place. And they change, of course, over time. Weather maps change radically in 24 hours, and maps of plant and animal ranges change radically in a decade and more radically in a century. All kinds of things change. And I've just shown us a few of those changes to prove my point. Yeah, that's better. There's a layer I hope David will add to his map sometime, if he hasn't added it already, and that is a map of the indigenous languages of Cascadia. There are at least 82 of those. Tlingit, Tawltan, Niskat, Tsimshan, Sakani, Haida, Haisla, Helsup, Gawikila, Wet'suwet'en, Nuchal, Daket, Chilkotan, Nikola, Kwakwala, Shuswap, Lillooet, Comox, Halkomelem, Clallam, Northern Straits, Lushootse, Nooksack, Pentlat, Seashelt, Squamish. I don't have to read you the whole list to make my point, do I? A lot. An incredible richness. Why do they belong on the map? Because languages are life forms too, just like the forests and the grasslands. They are living things. They are mortal. They die. They don't last forever. They grow up. They change. They live under good conditions, very long lives, thousands of years, but they don't last forever. They are not static. So even the language map would change, and sometimes, of course, catastrophic things happen and the language map changes radically. Invasive languages come in, like invasive plants and animals, and take over and sometimes destroy the languages that have been living in a place for a long, long time. So I put my language map over David's map last night and I counted 82 Cascadian languages. Only 50 of those languages are still spoken. Well, that's a lot, but it's not as many as before. And not one of those languages has as many native speakers now as it did before the colonization began. Not even close. So those things are worth putting on the map because they're real, because they're living things, but also because they belong here, because they learned how to live here. Every language has a literature. Most literatures never get written down, they're oral. And that's the way they live, and they live long, healthy lives in that form. But when you put a language under enormous pressure, like killing off its native speakers, moving them around, putting them in residential schools, and so on, the literature can be killed even before the language is. Why does that matter? Because literatures know things. Literatures are exactly what people choose to preserve, to cherish, to carry forward. They're the part of heredity that is not genetic, right? Requires active human involvement, storytellers, singers. And all of those literatures were literatures about the places where they lived. The main characters in the stories are the spirits of the land, the spirits of the air, the spirits of the sea and the rivers. They're not human beings. These are not stories about how people fell in love and got divorced and had children and abandoned them and had various fun things and then died. They're stories about how the earth lives its life and how people can live that life with it, in it. Stories about the world going on. And on, productively, with human beings as a part of it. We should put these 80, 82 languages in Cascadia in a kind of continental perspective, just as we should understand Cascadia as one of the bioregions of North America. There are about 300 native languages in Canada and the United States. More than half of those were spoken on the western slope, west of the continental divide. That is much less than half the continent. So if you look at a map of Aboriginal languages in North America, it's basically the reverse of a map of settler culture in North America. The population centers were not on the East Coast, they were on the West Coast. That's where the population density was, that's where the language density was, that's where the cultural density was. This was the cultural heartland of North America, the dense treasure house. And more than half of those languages on the Pacific slope were spoken at tidewater, right on the coast. Languages love water. They come to the beach. They come to the creeks. They come to the rivers. So a really impressive river, one really wide like the St. Lawrence or the Amazon, becomes a language boundary. People don't necessarily speak the same language on the two sides of the river, and a stretch of river that's really difficult like the Columbia Gorge becomes a language boundary because it's just not easy to get across. But a navigable river like the Skeena or the Nass, that becomes a language center. The same language is almost always spoken on both sides and up a long way. The language that the rivers draw, languages, they draw speakers, and of course they feed them when they get there. Every language has a literature. Everyone. A big, rich literature. And so, you know, if we're teaching the humanities in North America, that's where we should start. Every student in Cascadia should learn something about the geography, something about the geological history and the human history, but also the linguistic geography of this place. Right? Why doesn't every student at this university learn to speak Halkomelem, for example? That's the native language of this place. Yeah. Why not? Why shouldn't the people on my island quadra be speaking Kwala and Gomak? As they did once. Why shouldn't those be taught in the schools? We don't teach classical Greek and Latin anymore, so we could teach those classical languages instead. There's plenty of room in the curriculum. Well, we might find that it was actually, you know, really useful to study those languages because there were really things to learn that you wouldn't learn otherwise. And then we might remember that there were reasons for teaching classical Greek too. Because there were also things you could learn that way that you wouldn't learn otherwise. These languages have deep time depth and depth in the place. And so that's different from a language that spreads out over the earth that has great spatial extent, like English or Mandarin or Arabic or Latin, at once. The language roots itself in the place, and then the stories come up out of the ground into the language and into the speakers. So the language becomes an absolutely crucial part of the connection of the speakers with the place, with the water, with the rivers, with the beaches, with the rocks underneath, the weather overhead, the trees in the forests, or the grasses in the grassland, and the animals who move through, the ones that come up the rivers, and the ones that go over the mountains. That's why it matters. You cut that off, it's like poisoning your groundwater. So we should study these things. There's been some resistance to this idea, of course. It sounds, if you hear it the wrong way, like a proposal the white folks, having stolen everything else from the native people, should steal their languages too, the stories that are told. And that's not the point. Literatures exist for sharing. I mean, that's what they're for. They don't consist of the stories that people like to keep private. They consist only of the stories that people want to share. Those are the only ones that become literature. And languages exist for sharing because that's the only way they function. If you're the only speaker of a language, there is nobody you can talk to but yourself, and that's not enough. And languages change people, you see. If you learn Greek, you become a different person. You not only learn to drink retsina and eat moussaka, you learn to think different thoughts. You learned to understand what Socrates and Sophocles and Aeschylus had to say. Also people who were pretty closely connected to their places and were pretty close to the oral tradition in those places too. But if you take those stories out of the land where they were born and take them someplace else, they become something different. The way to put life back into them is for them to live alongside stories that do belong to the place where you've taken them. I'm saying, in other words, it would be much more valuable to read Shakespeare and Sophocles here in this place if we were also studying the stories that belong to this place, that grew up in this place, that belong here. That's the kind of connection that an imported plant or animal or language or literature needs. It needs to grow into the place where it's come. That's my thesis. Thank you.
No, keep going.
Convene our panelists up here for discussion among themselves, between themselves, and the audience as well.
No idea how to turn that off.
Okay, really? What about, is there a button up here? Let's not try too much. We might shut down the whole audio or something terrible could happen. Well, that has been a huge amount of food for thought. Tremendous diversity and range of information that all really overlapped very well. So I thought, before we open it up to the audience, do any of the three of you have any questions or comments to make to your fellow panelists? And do we need to use a mic for this part?
Yes.
Okay, then what we're going to do, you and I will share this, and we have another one. Who would like, sorry, a little bit of technical stuff going on here?
We're just going to pass it.
You want to pass it that way? Would you like to wear a lapel mic? We've got the technology. One, two. Is this? Does anybody hear anything?
No.
Oh, maybe we pushed a bad button.
Okay, got it.
Does this work? This works.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, this works. If you want to put that onto your lapel, Robert, I think we're good. You can just read that there. And Errol, we have this for you.
Wow.
I know. Everybody has a nice.
Technology wins again.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Okay.
Just a quick comment. The best I've ever heard. As clear and as deep as, where has Harold Rehnisch been all my life? Fabulous.
Anybody else have questions or comments for your panelists arising from talks?
I would just like to add to Robert's things that spending part of every day walking through the grass, trying to learn what it is that I'm looking at, I've come to realize that in a natural landscape, whatever that might be, plants too form languages and musical sequences, and just like the rock and the geology, these can be read. You can find your way across the land. It is a map by reading the plants, and that there is a further language between rock and plants that can be read. So.
Robert, do you have anything you want to say before we open it up?
Oh, I've talked too much already.
Okay. So, audience, who? Chris Lowther.
Carol, can you give us an example of what you just said about the language that you're talking about and how plants talk to each other? And I just need an example.
an example. Certain rock formations in the grasslands, certain angles of approach to the sun, certain types of basalt crumbling off of the slopes will produce certain water and shade conditions for certain kinds of plant communities. And if it is in your interest to gather plants for your food or medicinal needs, you do not have to search for them because you can read the land and you know where they are going to be. That's a broad example, but if you get on a closer level, certain plants form relationships in space of a certain distance. They are negotiating water in space and time as they try to hold it in place through a balance between gravity and the sun, and water moves in the grasslands through green life rather than through flowing surface water, and this green life tends to organize itself in almost linguistic or musical structures which you can track and follow.
Other questions or comments? Yes, George Stanley.
Yeah, I'll try to frame a question, mainly for Robert. You pointed out to us how the Aboriginal languages have cultural depth, as did the ancient, like ancient Greek. But on the other hand, languages which have simply spread in a kind of culturally surface way, like English, Arabic, Mandarin. The implication is that they would have difficulty in dealing with that cultural depth. Is there any possibility for a language like English to be able to say anything at all about the cultural and biophysical depths that Portuguese book always looked at?
Oh, I certainly think there is. Languages are living things. Because they're living things, they can learn things. If they couldn't, they wouldn't stay alive for
an
entire time.
Is this an expansion of vocabulary?
Well, vocabulary helps, but a language is by no means just a word list, and the literature is not just a language. It's the literature is where the learning. It's the brain of the language. The literature, and that's where the learning is going to take place, and it's going to happen. I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't write poems in English anymore because you don't live in England. I'm suggesting that if you were also a student of one or more indigenous languages from the place where you are living, that it would enrich your life. That you as a poet would have even more to say than you have already. That you could that your feet would be planted deeper in the ground. Uh, languages are things we use to talk, but talking is a very dangerous thing to do, you know? How about listening? Listening is a very good thing to do, especially when there's somebody with something to say. The Haida poet Sky, for example, told stories for weeks. The ethnolinguist John Swanson in the fall of 1900 when he showed up in the Haida country. The people who sent Swanson to the Haida country thought that they had sent him there to collect linguistic data, right? Word lists, lists of lineages and families, lists of villages, lists of place names, and so forth, so which they could put on index cards and put on the shelf in the Smithsonian. Swanton was a little smarter than that. Besides that, he knew what literature was, and he loved it. And when he met some real first-class storytellers, he sat down at their feet and took dictation for a year. He wrote back to the Smithsonian and said, "I can't leave now." He was only supposed to stay 3 months when he arrived. "I can't leave. I'm busy. The storytellers haven't finished yet." So, you know, Swanton learned things. He didn't learn to write in Haida or to speak Haida with any fluency. He learned to hear the language. He learned to understand what the storytellers were saying, and he came equipped to write what they said down in the phonetic script that his teacher had taught him. So from day one, even when he had no idea what people were saying, he could write down what they said, and later on he could find out what that meant. He continued to write in English, and he had lots of things to say in English because of what he was learning from the people who were teaching him in Haida 6 days a week. The missionary wouldn't let them work on the seventh day, but on 6 days a week. So on the seventh day, Swanton wrote letters to his mother and letters to his mentor, Franz Boas, and occasionally to his brother. And those letters are filled with incredible stories about the wonderful people that he met who were teaching him all these things on the other 6 days of the week. And then he went back to Washington and wrote two books edited his Haida texts. He spent 3 years typing them up on a typewriter and then putting miserable little marks all over it with his pen because the typewriter didn't have all the letters that he needed in order to write intelligible Haida. There's the kind of gift that David's talking about, this enormous gift. It doesn't mean that you can't speak English anymore. It means that English isn't enough by itself when there's a language that's already lived here for 5,000 years. Let's hear what that one has to say.
If I could add one comment to that, not to take anything away, but just a little gloss in the corner. English is a complex and abstract language that has evolved from many developments and linguistic collisions and much experience over a long period of time. But at its root, it is an indigenous language. At its root, there is indigenous experience and direct naming of forces of power in the world. Just a brief example, the word plant. Okay, the plant is not primary. The verb to plant is primary. The plant is a point at which one says the energy of growth will arise from the earth at that point. It is, the point is called a plant. What grows from it is the energy of the earth. We, because we're practical and we speak English, we call that growth of energy a plant, but at the core of our language, we're speaking about a magical act of enabling energy to come forth out of the earth. We have bridges. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Jenny McLeod, and I'm from Gabriel Island, and I'd like to just one comment about the land forming the art, if you will. And it is because my main training is in visual art, And I know for quite some time, Canadian artists were not considered to be real artists in Europe because our painting was so different. And then when I was older and I worked in an art and craft shop, and we started to sell prints by Benjamin Chi-Chi and the wonderful First Nations artists, they were not considered to be fine arts. And I think this is ridiculous, has now been redeemed by the artistic community. But this is just another way that the land actually reshaped the European artists that came here and was already well entrenched in the first Native artists that had always been here. And when the first Native artists adopted some of the techniques and the materials of the European, the imported materials of artists, then they, boy, they really showed them how to do it. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Yes, Gary.
Yeah. Well, basically just a comment, I guess, to Robert. As an Indigenous person and a speaker of my language as well, too, first of all, I want to thank you for doing such an eloquent presentation and providing that point of view about Indigenous peoples from this province and from this country and from this continent. So I've heard many, many people speak about the importance of it, but I've never heard it framed in the way that you'd said it, so thank you for that. I think the other thing in terms of your point about literature is that Aboriginal people in the country, there's been such a tremendous rise about getting that Aboriginal voice out there over the last 20, 30 years, and it's been a tremendous struggle to begin with. And I mean, there were the sort of the hand-picked romantic people, you know, Pauline Johnson and whoever else that, you know, the colonizers did not want to, or that wanted to uplift, and they didn't want to hear about the dirty shit that
right.
went on, basically.
Right. Right. Yeah.
So it takes a tremendous effort to be able to offer an andragogy or a pedagogy that the Canadian public will buy into, because of the value systems that are here. There is no value on Indigenous populations in this country. So to have the Canadian public buy into that is a tremendous, tremendous battle. And the final comment, I guess, I'm going to make is that when you take a look at it, the resistance to the Canadian history, one of the biggest attacks was towards our children. And in my language, the Sahuapni language, there are over 600 terms specifically related to teaching children. 600 terms. So that the essence of our whole beings was wrapped around children and teaching them their purpose at a very, very young age. When that type of, when the colonial policy came in, I mean, that was a direct attack on that.
Yes.
It wiped it out. But it scares the living shit out of Canada to hear those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And not only that, the government hides everything. It hides the history of this land, its relationships with people, its direct attack on languages, the languages that you're talking about. And I think if the general population in Canada understood that process, they would have a different mindset about placing a value system on the Indigenous languages and cultures that are formed from the very essence of what all three of you are essentially talking about. So thank you.
Well, thank you, Rehnisch.
Thank you. That was Gary Gottfriedson, who is one of our festival poets, and we'll be hearing. You're on a panel, aren't you, Gary?
I think so.
Yeah. But thank you.
Biodiversity. I don't know why I shouldn't be talking about culture and language.
I know. Yeah. Well, luck of the draw or something. But thank you very much for giving us, you know, a good long statement and very relevant.
I'll try to keep my statement shorter.
Oh no, long is good. Yes.
So I'm one of the college students who's lucky enough to be able to attend this festival, and I just want to say I've had the most amazing time so far. It's been really fascinating to see the overlap of what we're talking about here and what I'm learning about in my college classroom. One of the things that I've been studying a lot in my classes, and also one of the things that I feel such helps me feel such a strong connection to this place, our home, Cascadia, is water. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more to the importance of water in culture and geography and geology and in language.
Would any of you take a go with that?
Well, rivers are the veins and circulation system, and I think about the Cascades, for instance, or a waterfall, as a signature of the crossing of earth and sea and sky. So you know the whole place is implicated or woven together. And then when you're, the rivers here are tectonically controlled. The watersheds are tectonically controlled for the most part. And so the rivers then inscribe a living memory into the landscape. They animate it on all these levels. And from there, I hand it over to what it means.
I could perhaps give an example from the grassland hillside above my house, which is largely, but not quite completely, a hillside of weeds that used to support a wide variety of medicinal and food plants, and could again with care. The Okanagan Valley is renowned in Canada as being hot and dry, but one of the reasons it is dry is because in order to have Western style farming in the very hottest, driest part of the valley, water is piped down from the high country into the lowland, where it quickly vanishes into the air, because that's what the air has the capacity to take 11 times more water out of the soil than falls as rain. Any water you use there is instantly gone. Right? Whereas when it falls in the high country, it spends an entire season working its way down from level to level, feeding life on every stage, passing it on from one to the other in sometimes 1 or 2 week intervals, right? As they pass it on, and they slow water down and keep it. And the sun is trying to take it away, plants have developed mechanisms to stop it. So what we have done by, for understandable cultural and practical reasons, to create agricultural industry in the dry grasslands, we have made the grassland hillsides, which were abundant, into a drought landscape by removing the water that was originally there to slowly percolate through them. And we have replaced the wetlands at the bottom that catch that water and provide plankton to feed the lakes. We've replaced those with mobile home parks and soccer fields. So the water is life, and it has profound cultural consequences. We have, or culture has removed indigenous land use and removed indigenous people from that land, and that removal continues by the simple act of moving water where it doesn't belong.
Did you want to say something on that topic, Robin?
In Haida, there are two words for water. Tang is the salt water, seawater. Dandu is freshwater. It's also the word for creek or river. It's also the name of one of the finest myth tellers that John Swanson met when he spent his year in the Haida country, Gandu. So the missionary is called Gandu Walter because very creative, those missionaries. the finest myth teller that he met, without any question, was an old man named Sky. Sky is the name of a little whelk, a little sort of screw-shaped shellfish. In modern Haida, Sky means a screw, a wood screw, because that's what the shell looks like. So after Swan had been in the country for some months, people had realized that he was genuinely interested. He wasn't just there to collect word lists and then buzz off to the next language, but actually wanted to know what people had to say, and didn't go around, you know, interrogating them. He said, "Do you want to tell me a story?" So after he'd been there for a while, the old man, Sky, told him the story of the creation of the world. The first line of that story is Anis Hao Tang Lagagang Wansu. Hereabouts was all tang, salt water, everywhere, they say, Wansu. The Hitguangas Huya Gaugaslim Hao Gi Lapiana. He was flying over it, the raven was, looking for a place to perch, to sit. So the story starts with water. That's, you know, when the raven has to find his way down to the bottom of the sea in order to acquire what is necessary to create land, Cascadia, Haida Gwaii, so that people will have a place to live. But it isn't. He doesn't do this for the benefit of humans. He does it for the benefit of the spirit beings, the skana, the killer whales, the sea people. And then, because they need people to come to the pot match, humans are created because they need witnesses. That's what humans are for.
I want to put this off. I just want to myself follow up on a comment that Robert made in his talk that also relates to something Gary raised. This notion of, will there ever be a time when a map, a Cascadia map of indigenous languages is produced. That would be very interesting. And in terms of Gary's comment that if the Canadian public knew, if the Canadian public were aware of what has historically gone on, what has been lost, what is, continues to be lost, if the Canadian public just knew more, that would change perception. Certainly a good first start. I like that idea of a mapping of indigenous languages.
Kroger's maps, of course, of Northern California and the West were classic. Cameron Suttles has a wonderful language map of this region. And I don't know what map you were using.
Mine. And yours.
There's the map.
So the map in some form or another exists and forms.
Oh, yeah.
The mapping has occurred.
Yeah.
But could more could occur.
There are lots of maps. The Smithsonian Institution produced a good map of the whole of what they call ethnographic North America,
yeah.
Which starts, you know, somewhere at the bottom of northern Mexico and runs to the top of Canada. It's maps are never finished. Maps are never perfect.
Right.
It's a pretty good map. It was published as an insert to the language volume of the Encyclopedia of North American Indians, an unfinished encyclopedia. And then the University of Nebraska Press published it as a separate publication. So you can buy this map in two or three different sizes from detailed maps of particular areas, and you know, there's always more work to do on these maps, like there's always more work to do on the dictionaries and the grammars and everything else that goes with languages.
It never stops.
Nothing is ever finished. No.
When are we going to see your
map? You're not going to see it. I'm an oral person.
We have time for perhaps one more question or comment. Yes, Susan.
Thanks. My daughter is an educator, and I think she and I both accept Robert's thesis that Indigenous languages, it would be a wonderful idea if they could be taught in the schools. But I could hear my daughter saying to me, Mom, that's not going to happen. You know, she's up against the Christie Clark government, the cuts, and the public's attitude toward education, training rather than depth, deep time learning, and so on. And so it suddenly occurred to me that I started thinking about utopian visions of going back to Plato's Republic, Thomas More, Ursula Le Guin, you know, just the whole history of utopian literature. And I just wondered what the panelists would say about whether, as poets here, we're dreaming utopian, and I don't mean that in any cynical way, I'm kind of utopian myself, but I'm thinking maybe a utopia is grounded in the earth rather than some conceptual, you know, springing from the imagination and the land. And just, you know, thinking why utopias often fail in the literature as well, you know. Plato's Republic didn't actually work out in real historic time. And what's the value of looking at this map is a kind of, it's a reality, the land, but the political boundaries are there and we have to deal with them every day. So what do we have to offer the community in terms of this kind of big dreaming about how it could be better? So.
Just on the last note, politics needs to be put in its place.
Really?
There are no lines on, well, there are lines on the map because they, I had to do it. They made me do it. But if you start with the life of the land, and then we work out an ecological metabolism, not a footprint, but an ecological metabolism to relate to the place, which then generates the community and the economy, then the celebration of that would be the culture. And then once you have a culture, then you could grow a life place politics. So let's put that in the right order.
Susan, it's not just utopianism, you know. There are universities in this country now where you can study Cree. There are universities where you can study Tsimshian. There might one of these days be a university where you can study either, who knows. You know, 100 years ago this was unthinkable. Right? The authorities would not have tolerated it. No, Christie Clark is not on our side, and Stephen Harper is not on our side, but they won't be here forever. Right? You look at how dependent we all are on the goodwill and the fortitude of Native people in Canada now, and especially in this province, you know, with vicious provincial and federal administrations who want nothing more than to suck fossil fuel for the rest of their short lives. The First Nations are just about the only people who have any hope of putting barriers in the way through legal action. It was only the other day that the judge finally observed officially the obvious, which is that Native people have been here for a long time and they don't have to prove that they're Native people in order to have legal standing as such. That's really quite remarkable, you know? I mean, it's like a judge finally discovering that there are clouds in the sky. But he said it, and so now it's not, now it's official. But look at the pressures, right? Petrobras, the Malaysian national oil and gas company, has offered the Lac Qualam band, just north of Prince Rupert, $1 billion plus for agreeing to accept the pipeline and the outflow station on their land. There are 3,300 people in the Lac Qualam band, 800 of them living on reserve. $1 billion is a lot of money for those people. So it's not entirely surprising that the elected leaders of the Lac Qualam band have recommended to their people that they accept this offer. And now there'll be an election, a vote there, a plebiscite, and we'll see what the people say. But look at the absolutely incredible pressure being put on them. First you take everything away from them, and then you say, well, we'll give you $1 billion if you agree to go along, right? That stinks. But that's what's happened.
We have, Harold, 1 minute.
Just very briefly, you spoke about utopias and poetic visions of utopias. I would just like to remind us all that California, Oregon, Washington, British Columbia in many different ways, and Alaska are all the creations of utopian visions, and our entire political and social structures are utopian. In some vision speaking to Cascadia and a non-politically divided think are a counter to the destructive tendencies within these utopian visions.
Very good point. We are almost at the end of our event here, our first panel, but we have one thing we're going to do before I thank everybody, and that is happening right now.
I am the Panelist Spirit from the heart of Cascadia. I am most honored to present this to you, sir, for all your life on earth and everything you are.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
I want to thank you all for listening, for participating, for thinking about everything that was raised here today in this panel about the intersections between geography, culture, language. I want to thank the fabulous panelists, David McCloskey, Harold Rehnisch, Robert Bringhurst.